Monday, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. Specifically today, what we're doing hang about Monday is we are hanging around. I'm shooting some reviews today, but we're hanging around talking about arpeggios. This has been a running topic for us for some time. It's a good number of weeks now, but it's something that really does bear drilling down on. We started this way back in our acoustic streams that our friends from Fishman brought to us, which was a lot of fun, and our friends from Elixir as well. But this kind of became one of the subjects that you guys were asking about, you were sending me messages about, and I thought it would be cool to do a really big deep dive on it, and also I thought it'd be pretty cool to shoot a course on it, but I'll talk to you about that another time. So that's coming. The All About Arpeggios course is in the can. It is coming. Ask and you shall receive. Listen, if you are a first-time viewer, I want to take this opportunity to thank you for coming on board. It's great to have you. We do these every Monday. It says so, like down here, Mondays at 8 p.m. UK time. As you can probably tell, we're down in the Romford studio. So we're here shooting some cool content. We've been looking at some great guitars, been doing a little review of this amp as well. This amp's been rocking my world for a little while. It's the Victory Super Sheriff. But we're here to talk about some arpeggios. If you're one of our returning cadre of streamers, thanks for coming on board. It would be very, very lonely without you. And let me know quite where to look on these studio streams as well down here, because it's a little bit different to my streaming setup at home. I've got my laptop down here so I can see your comments. Speaking of which, let's check in with the comment section and see how everyone's doing. We've got lots of folks in tonight, but let's do some hellos. So first of all, Marcin is not the first one in the house, if you can believe it. It's our friend PJ, who says, hi Nick, SGS and all. It's great to be back. PJ, it is great to have you back. Marcin, second in the house. David Yates is here, good to see you. Timothy Appling is here, who I keep calling Timothy Appalling. It would be a great name for a punk band. It's one of them running jokes that we've got going on, I think. Good afternoon, Nick, and the usual early guitarist. Timothy, it is great to see you. Foghornish is here. Ah, very interesting. Timothy Appling said he's had the Headrush 108 on back order for the last several weeks, and it was shipped from Sweetwater today. Wanted to try an FRFR speaker with my Headrush MX5. Well, I can confirm that that little configuration works really, really well. I mean, they're made for each other, so they would do. But my friend Alan, who is the other guitar player in Blitzkrieg, he uses those in rehearsal. He doesn't take them with him when we play, because normally we have to fly, and flying with FRFR is a bit of a nightmare. There's always monitors at the venue as well, but he uses them in rehearsal. They sound fantastic with a Headrush MX5, no less. Very cool combination of a speaker and cab. I'm sure you're going to get a lot of fun out of it. I myself, I'm really quite eager to check out the Laney FRFRs with a little more, I guess a little more thoroughness. So I've played through them before. I know Guthrie's playing through them now, which I think has got a lot of guitar players going, maybe I should get one of those. And I'm no exception here. I'm kind of thinking that too. So just following on from that, Timothy says, I've been using it through my small amp set to clean, also using my studio monitors. The 108 was cheap and lightweight. It's a little like having a studio monitor, I guess. It's a little bigger than your typical studio monitor, but it is light, nice and easy to take to and from rehearsals and gigs. You can probably even do it on public transport if that's your sort of thing. But yeah, it makes a big difference, man. It's a cool sounding setup. I reckon you'll have a lot of fun with it. So who else do we have in the house? Sounds good in my room. Should sound good in my room, rather, says Timothy. Somebody on this live session mentioned it. I mentioned they had the Headrush 108 and liked it. Well, it's a very, very cool setup. I think you're really going to enjoy it, man. Good choice. Let us know how you get on with it when it arrives. Mark Crandall is in the house. Hey, Nick. Hey, guys. Hope everyone is doing well. Cooking here in SoCal. Are you guys getting this heat wave that's been going around? So we've managed to escape it, thankfully, but I really do feel for our friends in Europe and in America who are suffering with this crazy soaring temperature, this Cerberus heat wave. It sounds nuts. There's a 1% chance we're going to get it in the UK. And if we do, we'll just all catch fire. We'll just burst into flames, and that'll be the end of it. No more UK, just some scorched earth. We're not equipped to deal with the heat, so I feel for you. Last time we were in LA, not the last time, the time prior was in June, and the temperature was brutal, just like beyond brutal. So I do feel for you. David Yates is in the house, says, Timothy Appling, have you looked at the Line 6 power cabs as a speaker? I've not tried one, but the demos I've seen seem pretty solid. Nick might have tried one, might have an idea if they are good. I have tried one indeed. Played with one when it came out, one of the original PowerCab Plus 112s, we did a review of that. It's available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. I think it sounds great, and there's lots of clever features. I like the idea of the speaker modeling that's going on there. So that's something on the Plus that's a lot of fun to play with. So rather than just taking your mic'd IR and then piping it out of an FR-FR speaker, what the PowerCab does, and I don't know quite how they've achieved this, but it's very, very clever, is it actually models the activity of a number of specific guitar speakers. So you have a Vintage 30, I think there's an Eminence Swamp Thang, if I'm not mistaken, there's a Jensen, there's an Alnico Blue, there's a Greenback, the usual candidates, but it actually models the sound of just the speaker and not the microphone in front of the speaker. So it does feel very much like playing live in front of an amp. However, I have heard some reports from folks that they're not quite loud enough. I don't know what these people are doing, because when we played with it, it was brutally loud. But even still, you never know, right? Some of you guys just want loud, 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 loud. Here we go. Hello, everyone. I'm a bit overwhelmed by the amount of info that's in there. Nick, how do you narrow in on what to work on? We all know what our weaknesses and our strengths are. What should be our priority? Larry, that's a great question. I'm going to star that up and we're going to answer that in our Q&A section. So if you guys haven't remembered, by the way, or if you don't know, if you're a new viewer, we do a Q&A at the end of each one of these streams. So that's going to be one of the questions that we will address in our Q&A section. And we'll try and get into some detail about that. It's a very, very good question. Very good question. Sacred Godslayer says, I'm also using one of the head rushes, hoping it will serve you well too. Certain it will. Here we go. Yeah, Nick mentioned the Laney. They're not easily accessible in the US. I know distribution is one of those things that kind of varies from territory to territory. So they're very available in the UK, but I know there's a big kind of like markup on British amps in the US, and it goes in other directions as well. So US amps are very expensive in the UK. It's just the import export thing, but we have the luxury of having lots of cool amps that are made in the UK that are fairly affordable over this way. So we got lots of discussion on that. We're going to come back to that. We'll go a little bit further forward because really, really interesting stuff. And we're getting onto Marshalls. I need to highlight this very quickly from David Yates. David Yates always has the best stories. I'm just throwing that out there, right? He's done all the things. So I've had a few Marshalls myself. One time I was running a 19, we were in a super lead, amazing. Okay, and a JCM 800 with three 4x12 cabs. The cabs are really cheap, about £100 used. Oh my word, that's pretty outrageous. Now I've picked up some bargains in my time, but that's quite something, that's wild. Anyway, Daryl Queen is in the house. Daryl, it is great to see you. Cranker Tom is here. Playing his Duesenberg Star Player 3. Very cool guitars, very underrated. Don't get the love they deserve. Steve McDee's in the house. Steve, it is good to see you. Kim is tuning in from what I'm assuming is a sunny location. It might actually just be his garden, but Kim is an international man of mystery. I was at his house last night, but that does not mean that he's still in the country. Who knows? Kim likes to travel. So I'm assuming Kim is tuning in from his house. I keep saying tuning and Kim and mixing them up because it's been a very long day. Always want to try Duesenberg. They're great guitars. Go out and grab one, let me tell you. Rory Lisbon is here, says, hey ho. Rory always has great insights. Who else do we have? Response Audio is in the house. Good to see you. Who else do we have? Robert Lisbon is saying Tone X, anybody? Now, Sam Bell has checked out a Tone X in a review in Guitar Interactive magazine. I have yet to play one, but I gather they are fantastic for the sound, but the UI, maybe less so. I'm a quad cortex guy. You guys know that already, but that's just one of them things. So we're just going to see if we've got anybody else who I haven't said hello to, and then we're going to crack on because I could sit and talk about this all day. Nick the Pick, aka Menacing Jennison. We like that. I guess it's as I'm becoming progressively larger, I'm becoming more menacing. Less menacing, if anything. More teddy bear-like. Who knows? I'm even covered in velvet today, so very teddy bear-like. Hi, boys. Due to this extreme climate change, I wonder why the industry doesn't build more stable guitar necks. Dude, you have asked the question we've all been asking for a very long time. We, and James is nodding off camera here, we've had loads of bother today trying to keep guitars in tune. And these are great guitars, but the room has been really warm where we've been shooting, and they've just been coming and going, and it's been a pain in the neck. Pun not intended, but thoroughly relished. Anyway, Mike Seedorf is here. It is good to see you. Have I been talking this whole time with no voice? I don't think so. Hopefully you guys can hear me. James is nodding. Hopefully we can hear me. We had some stuff with no dialogue. I think that just came in a little bit later on. That is fine. Yeah, voice, it's back. Fab. Good. I hoped I hadn't been talking for like 15 minutes with no voice. That would be embarrassing. Jason Carter is in the house. Who else do we have? My friend Craig is here. Craig, it is good to see you. Mal Riley is here. It's good to have you on board. Also cooking in Phoenix, Arizona. Wow, 111 Fahrenheit. That is bonkers. Absolutely insane. Raid Leader is here. Good to see you. Sacred God Slayer. Slayer, are you Italian? Sacred God Slayer is our Italian correspondent. Anybody else? I think that is everyone. So, hello to you all. Good to have you on board. Let's get stuck in with the meat of today's session. So today, we are continuing our discussion on arpeggios. We're kind of picking up a little bit on a topic that I've talked to you guys about at length in the past, but also in some of our other streams, which is this term that I've made up. It's not a real term, but let's be honest, there are no real terms when it comes to any of this stuff. They're all made up. But this is a term that I've coined, I'm going to say, that I think of as tonal density. Let's establish that very quickly and work out what we're talking about. So we talked about this last week when we talked about the, and certainly a few weeks ago, when we talked about the idea of playing with triad arpeggios, four-note arpeggios, pentatonic scales, six-note scales, seven-note scales, etc. Today, we're going to talk about blurring the lines between them, and specifically with arpeggios. But let me just give you an example. Let's go to the close-up cams for this. I'm going to throw the backing track back on. This backing track is, of course, available on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, but let's start by taking a look at some triad arpeggios, which may look something like this. A very familiar sound. Let's expand that out. We're going to skip a step and go straight to some pentatonic scales, which might sound like this. With some of the more traditional licks we tend to associate with pentatonic scales, let's go another step further, just a little bit further. This time we're going to do some seven-note scales, which maybe sound like this. Let's go one step further again. This time we'll do some chromatic scales, which might sound like this. So forth. Now, what we can hopefully hear with this is the further down this road we go, the more information that we start to introduce into our, into our pool of notes. I always use this term pool of notes, into our hand of cards that we have to pick from when it comes to choosing the notes that we're going to play. The more information we introduce, the more notes that we introduce, the denser, let's say, the denser the tonality becomes. So this is why I use the term tonal density, because it's a way of making the sound that you're making sound denser, for want of a better word. And as it becomes more dense, it becomes less sharply focused on a specific tonality. If we take a listen to an E minor triad arpeggio, for example, which would be this. Obviously, I have to excuse those. I've got quite tired hands from shooting a bunch of reviews today. That is very, very focused on this particular sound. It sounds about as E minor as you can get. As we start to bring other notes in, we start to deviate a little bit further from that. So let's take, for example, an E minor pentatonic scale. I'm going to have to cough, excuse me, one moment. I have to give James the cough warning so James can turn the microphone off. So real quick, if we take this E minor arpeggio and we convert it into an E minor pentatonic, it still sounds pretty tightly focused on this E minor. It hasn't started sounding like this yet, or like this, or any of these other. It still sounds very much like that, but the information is becoming more diffuse. As we start to convert this into a seven note scale, which might be something like this, for example. To lose a little bit of the focus of that arpeggio, a little bit of the focus of that triad arpeggio, and it can stop sounding like this so much and start sounding like, for example, this, or like this, or like this maybe, depending upon how we emphasize particular notes within our scale. I'm going to show you how to do this in a second, so don't worry, this is just establishing a premise with this sort of thing. So let's talk about how we might start to blend this stuff in some arpeggios. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna give you a very simple formula, let's say, for incorporating some additional notes into your arpeggios, and we're gonna begin with some arpeggios at the top end. So let's start with some of these sequenced arpeggios that we looked at last week, because this is something that we took a peek at when we started doing some of these famous arpeggio sequences, like the, what do you call it? The rising force arpeggios, that's the one, which is the one that has the. With all those kind of good, lovely sounding notes that are in between the arpeggio, let's do some of those. So we're going to begin, we're in the key of E minor for this, we're going to begin with an E minor arpeggio. So our E minor arpeggio in its simplest form is probably this. Now, for those of you playing along, if you've got your guitars, grab your guitars, because you should be playing along today, we are going to be playing this fret number 5 on the B string, fret number 3, and fret number 7 on the high E string. So that gives us E, G, and B. Typical arpeggio sort of stuff, nothing out of the ordinary here. We're going to begin by improvising using just those notes. So let's throw the backing track on. We're going to use just these notes, and we'll see what we can accomplish. We'll do a little bit of back and forward. So I'm going to start. James, do me a favor. You can turn the monitors down for me, just the whole monitor setup, just a tiny bit. Great. So fabulous. And much better. Okay, so let's try doing something like this. So I'm going to play. And improvise me something using just those notes, just those three notes there. That is literally all we need. I'll give you a little bit longer, because I took a nice long pass there. Then we're going to introduce one additional note in the middle that's going to make this a little more interesting. So if I go like so, you're probably already bored of this. I know. I find it quite challenging. Making music with just these notes, you take a turn, and then I'll show you the note that we're going to throw into the middle here. The note that we're going to throw into the mix is going to be this note here, which is fret number 5, which is in the middle of our arpeggio. It's an A note, it's the 11th, and it's going to turn our arpeggio from this, have a listen, into this. Some of that arpeggio with this extra middle note thrown in for good measure. Now, the reason we framed it like this is I want you to think about these outside arpeggio notes as the thing that we're playing and this is kind of bonus. So I'll take a turn. I'm not going to spend too much time living on this note. I'm going to focus most of my attention on these arpeggio notes. I'm going to encourage you to do the same. So give me a little play. Same deal. Those arpeggio notes with this note in the middle as like an extra bonus note. Let's have one more go each, then we're going to add one more into the mix. So if I go like this, overestimated the strength of my first finger there. We take a turn. Now we're doing this for you. There's a reason we chose this. Because I'm going to take you in a little direction next. So there is another bonus note that we're going to add into the midst of our arpeggio here. And the bonus note we're going to add in is fret number 6. So now we have this. Add that 5 and that 6 into this arpeggio shape. Now we're starting to create something interesting. I'll talk to you about what it is in a minute, but if you know what this is giving us, you know what scale this is starting to form, drop it in the comments and let me know. I'm going to go like this. I'm not going to spend much time here or here. Spend most of my time here. Take a turn, again using just that arpeggio, these extra notes that we've thrown in here. I'm going to let you finish this one, and then we're going to come back out and we're going to talk about what's going on here. Okay, let's wind that back out. So what have we done here when we're playing this sort of thing? Well, let's go back to the main cam. So what we've done here is we have essentially taken our arpeggio, we've introduced an 11th, and also what you could consider to be a sharp 11, it's actually a flat 5, is the way we tend to think about this. Now, I want to know from you guys, we've got the answers, fabulous. David H says, sounds a bit blues scaly. Falcon H says, minor blues, chromatic, a flat 5 starts to sound like a blues scale. It 100% does. Now, this is interesting, because we haven't even played the full blues scale yet. All we've done is we've taken our minor arpeggio and we've introduced this flat 5 note and this note as well for good measure. We don't actually need the 11th, but it's a good way to introduce it without it sounding disastrous. What we're starting to do here is we're starting to take this arpeggio as an outline. So this is almost like if you're coloring in, let's say, these are the lines that we're coloring in between. And what we can start to do here is we can start to color in whatever we want in between the lines. So we could take this a little bit further. Now here's an interesting one, right? Sacred God Slayer says, I fell on the flat 5, but it sounds good only if you close the phrase on the root or the 5th. I'm kind of inclined to agree with you, because if we play like this, it can sound cool, but it doesn't sound terribly finished, whereas if we play this, that can sound very, very together. Now, what we're dealing with here is we are essentially playing with this idea of the arpeggio being the most focused and the most clear version of the sound that we're trying to get. And then these chromatic notes that we're filling in the middle, we're using almost as seasoning or kind of like flavor or just some kind of distraction from the arpeggio notes so we don't get sick of it. An example you might think about this as is almost like a perfume analogy. Now, we've all been in a situation where we've been at a social gathering, maybe even at a party or whatever, and somebody's just wearing way too much perfume, like just so much perfume, it's all you can smell. All you can smell. And then after a while, you just kind of get used to it and it stops being terribly noticeable. You just kind of adapt to it. And then you go outside, you get some fresh air, you talk to some folks, you go and use the bathroom, and then you come back and all you can smell is perfume. Like, that is literally just offensively perfumey. These chromatic notes are a little bit like that. Lynx Africa, said David Yates, the greatest fragrance in the world, apparently. I love that that's how they're marketing it these days. They've gone, you know what? This is it. This is the greatest fragrance. Like, I absolutely love it. You smell like a flat five, says Response Audio. Smell like a flat something. Anyway, so what we're doing here anyways, we have these extra notes that we can throw in that just take a little bit of that arpeggio-iness away, so that when we start playing the arpeggio again, it smells like perfume again to us, if that makes sense. Now, let's advance this a little step further. So, a couple of ways we can do this, but one thing we're going to start doing is we're going to start playing some other shapes. So, let's take the same idea, but let's treat ourselves to a second arpeggio. And the easiest way to get it is to play exactly the same thing, but starting here on B. So, if we have an E minor, which is here, and then up here we have a B minor. If we look at the notes that we have contained in these two arpeggios, we have E, F sharp, G. We don't have an A, but we have two lots of B, and then we have a D. So if we play this and this at the same time, what it amounts to is this. It's a way of kind of getting an E minor 9 sound. But what we're going to do is we're going to take this E minor, with the addition of the 11 and the flat 5, and then we're going to play exactly the same thing up here with your second finger on the 12th fret. So we play here, here, and here, with the addition of this note and this note too. So this, in this case, is actually giving us an E, there's our root, and then a flat 9, which can actually sound really cool. I'm gonna show you how this works along with our backing track. So the same arpeggio, two places. Let's start with just playing the arpeggios with no fill-in notes, which is gonna sound like this. Sounds kind of cool. Let's throw in some fill notes. I'm going to ask you to take a turn. So this arpeggio here starting on 5, this arpeggio here starting on 12. Fill in the notes to your heart's desire. It's going to sound cool. It's just going to work, especially that flat 9, which doesn't necessarily sound that great on its own, but, you know, if you fill it in, I'll take a turn now. If we play that, it sounds horrendous. But if we play this, it sounds cool. So you take a turn. Again, the important thing here is that the arpeggio is kind of our outline, if that makes sense. The arpeggio is our framework. And then we're filling it in with these additional chromatic notes, just to kind of give ourselves a little bit of color. I'm gonna take one more turn and we'll start throwing some more in now. You take a turn. I overstayed my welcome there. And you can take the last turn here. So we're gonna finish that there. Now, that sounds pretty cool. I'm sure you agree. Krakatom says the expensive tone is F sharp. Response Audio says sounds groovy. Both of those things are true. Incidentally, by the way, if you're playing in E minor pentatonic and you want to sound expensive, just play like an F and then F sharp like this, and then you'll get this kind of. And so on and so forth. So that works really, really well. Let's go a little step further with this. So we're gonna treat ourselves to a few more arpeggios. Now, what we discussed in previous weeks is that if we're in the key B minor, which we are right now, we can start to incorporate any of the arpeggios from E minor, and we should be safe. But we're going to do some really good classic ones here. We're going to start with a G, which is going to look something like this. So our G is going to be a major arpeggio, and this is going to make us nice and easy, make it nice and easy for us to play these fill-ins as well. So if we have a G here, where we play a G note, which is fret number 8 on the B string, a B note with a finger pinched harmonic, a B note, which is fret number 7 on our high E string, and then fret number 10 on our high E string, we get this. Now, so far, that gives us this, this, and this. We're going to have one more, which starts on D, which is going to be right here, and it's going to be another major shape, like our G shape. It's exactly the same. We get 15, 14, 17. So here we get this. And all together, we have E minor, G major, B minor, and D major. These in totality add up to an E minor add 11 chord, which is this. Really beautiful chord. If you want to know the chord, ask me in the comments and I'll show you a bit later on. So that's a beautiful sound. We have that with our arpeggios, but unlike these minor shapes, when we play these major shapes, there are only two spaces that we can fill. We can fill this one and this one. So we can get this or this. And suddenly we have a chromatic scale, which is interesting. So we get this. And we're starting to sound like we're playing jazz here, but we have a framework. It's not like we're just playing this. Which is fun if you're doing John Petrucci's rock discipline, but rather we're starting to sound like we're actually making music here. So we've got some fill-in pitches that I'm going to show you once again, along with the backing track. Let me show you where this is, and then we can take some turns. So if we go here, let's start with an E, which we can fill here. We have a G. Fill in there. We have a B, which we can also fill. And a D, which we can fill here. And now we're playing some really cool, expensive sounding things. So I'm going to take a pass, and I'll ask you to do the same. And then we'll start to go a little bit deeper with this. This is just a way of illustrating the point. You don't just have to play it here. So if I go like this. You take a turn. So again, we have an E minor and a B minor. G major and a D major, we can fill the middle of those arpeggios in to our heart's content, and we know it's going to work because the arpeggio is our outline. We know that that's where we start and finish, and we also know that that's where kind of the, I guess, the edges of our sound kind of lay. So let's go a little bit deeper with this. I'm going to go one more time, and I'm going to go like this. You guys will undoubtedly see me play this lick alone. It's a real favorite of mine, and it follows the same principle. So what I'm going to show you next is we're going to take one more step with this. And what we're going to start doing is we're going to start to take our... I'll just quickly stop this, and I'll show you on the main cam. So I'll show you this real quick. We're going to take one more step with this particular example. And what we'll do, if we just go to the main cam real quick, it's probably easier if I show you here, is we're going to take this same idea of playing this arpeggio, but as we've been filling in these notes, we've kind of, in fact, you know what it is, let's go back to the close-up cam. My mistake, let's go back to the close-up cam. We've left this note unmolested. This is our, I guess, our major third, or you could even consider it a flat 11. Please don't call it that. But either way, it's a note that we don't necessarily want to hang on our E minor, but we can use it as a perfectly valid passing tone in our chromatic studies. So we could take this. And it's gonna work. Now the same is true up here. We can throw in these notes, also that one there, which in this case is gonna be fret number 11. This gives us, when we play up our high E string from here, all the way up to here, a complete chromatic scale, which gives us this. So we have one octave and a bit of chromatic scale. And if I'd said to you at the start of this, unless you're a skilled jazz guitarist or, you know, you've played this sort of thing already, if I'd said to you, hey, just play the chromatic scale on the E string, it probably wouldn't have sounded as cool as it's about to sound. So let's go back to our arpeggios, back on the back track. We'll take some turns and let's see what we get. So if I start here, you take a turn, fill it into your heart's content, but remember that arpeggio is serving as your outline. That's the important bit, because those are good notes. And if you keep that fixed in your head, all these other little expensive notes that we're throwing in, they're just gonna kind of add to things. So I'll go like this. Take a turn, take some short turns here. We don't have to play everything. We don't have to play all the notes. We've got plenty of time to experiment. So I'll go a little deeper on this. I'm gonna go like this. Take a turn. A little lost in my own nonsense there. We ended up on some other strings, but that's fine. So we're gonna just come out of that real quick. So that's an example of what we might think of as using arpeggios in this case as an outline to start filling in some chromatic notes around. But here's the fun thing. You don't just have to do it in the top part of this arpeggio. That's just a nice way to get used to it. You don't have to do this thing where you play arpeggio shape. And then when we get to the top, we start filling chromatics in. It's kind of a fun thing to do. Already at the top, so we can just live there and pick it for a little bit. So you might get something really cool like this. You can play the sweeps a little more cleanly than I can anyway. You might get something very, very cool, but that's not the only place we can start to find these arpeggios. We have kind of already established that we can basically justify playing pretty much any note in the context of pretty much any arpeggio, because we've just done it. We played literally a whole chromatic scale up the high E string. Every one of those notes worked. So theoretically, what we could then do is we could then start to expand out of this and take a look at any of the arpeggios that we like to play and start to just play some chromatic notes around them and see what happens, with a view to kind of filling the arpeggio notes in. So let's go to perhaps the bottom half of this. We'll go to the close-up cam. Perhaps the bottom half of this E minor arpeggio, which might be like this. So here, what could we play? We could play this. And we could fill in here. We could go to here and here. often play this. And it still sounds like, just a little more dense. Here we could play, that would work. And then what have we got? We've got all sorts of chromatic wonderment. What am I thinking of when I'm playing this? This. And just trying to correct course back into that where, correct course back into that when it starts to sound a bit weird. Let me give you a more, I guess a more out there example. So let's go back to the backing track. And I'm gonna play some fuller size arpeggios, but with some of this stuff in. So if I start to go, admittedly, that did get quite shreddy, but that's okay, because sometimes with this stuff, with this kind of, I guess this kind of really, really shreddy, you know what it is, right? Cowcat has nailed it with Brett Garsett filling in the gaps. It's basically what it is. We're basically using this arpeggio as an outline, but this is important because it gives form to what it is that we're doing, because you can't just play, you could, I'm saying you can't. You can play what you want. You can play anything you like, right? But it would probably be ill-advised to play just the chromatic scale up and down with no idea of what's going on around it, unless that's an aesthetic effect that you're going for. Going for the confused bee kind of sound, let's say. Let's go with that. The flight of the wounded bumblebee, etc. But just having this idea of where this arpeggio is and then filling in chromatically around that, it's magic. What you'll also start to notice, by the way, is how many famous songs, how many famous melodies are literally just a minor arpeggio or a major arpeggio with a chromatic tone below. So let's go to the closer gram. It might be something like this, for example. Or maybe, I don't know. Let's think of another one. Just all manner of kind of like famous or even just like pseudo famous sounding tracks are just this. It's literally an arpeggio with, the chromatic tone below, played before the arpeggio notes. It's a device people have used forever, and it sounds really, really good. Here's an interesting one from our friend Sacred Godslayer. It says, root flat to root seventh root, and then another combination of notes that you should write down, and you're into, that's a guitar player I need to check out, because I've not heard this name before. That is, what is that? Malaguenda Salarosa. I am going to check that name out, because I've not heard that. I've not heard this person before, so I am assuming, because Sacred Godslayer is a very well-educated and very skilled guitar player, that this is going to be somebody who is going to rock my world. So anyway, listen, guys, this has been a little bit of a look into how you might convert arpeggios into chromatic scales. I'm sure you can imagine. Oh, it's mariachi. Excellent. Right, we're definitely going to check that out. There we go. So anyway, this is a look at how you can convert this into chromatics from triad arpeggios. I'm sure you can imagine how you might start to do this, but on a less full-on scale, and convert, say, for example, a pentatonic scale into a chromatic scale, or a triad arpeggio into a pentatonic scale, or for example, a seventh arpeggio into a six note major scale or something like that. If you want a little bit more help with this, I guess, a good place to begin is the course we've got on Mastering Modes Part 1, because this covers how to convert pentatonic scales into modes. So if you're new on this sort of subject and you're going, wow, my head is spinning, or even if you just kind of know the modes, but you feel like you're hitting the modes button every time it's time to play, and you're playing converts from this. This is a great Guthrie Govan example. You're playing converts from this. Into this. Every time somebody says, hey, play modes. Music, now modes. Still music, but not very exciting music. If you have that, then you should check out this course. This is Mastering Modes Part 1. When we come back, we're going to be answering your questions live on air. But first, check this out. Modes. What are modes? How do I use them? When do I use them? Well, modes are one of the things that the pros use to add excitement and color to the guitar parts, and there is no reason why you can't use them too. Now, for some reason, people, especially certain online guitar teachers, love to make modes seem complicated and scary, but I'm here to tell you they really, really aren't. And in fact, if you know the pentatonic scale, I can show you how to play modes with just two extra notes. In this course, I'll show you how to play careless sounding guitar solos using modes without any of the mystery. You'll learn how to play musical sounding solos all across the neck in any key, crucially without sounding like you're just running up and down scales. So, you ready to take this next step with me? Click the link to find out more. So there you go, guys. That's a little bit of a peek at one of our courses. This is Mastering Modes Part 1. Our friend Jason is asking the question. Jason Carter, I've signed up for an all-access pass for GI Plus. Thank you very much for signing up. I appreciate that, by the way. Your GI Plus subscriptions are what enable us to keep doing these streams. So you are supporting us, and you're keeping these lessons going with your subscriptions. That is very, very well appreciated. Says, will I be as good as you in a week or two? I don't see why not. You know, why not? Who knows? I mean, if you practice enough, maybe. I don't know. Maybe you're like only that far away. Maybe you're better than me already. Maybe you're going to get worse in the process. I hope not. Fingers crossed. But no, I do appreciate the compliment, man. That's very, very kind of you. And thank you for signing up. I do appreciate that. David Yates says, safe to say Nick knows his onions. I can recognize a red and a white onion. Very much so. I'm dressed as a red onion today. But thanks, man. I do appreciate that. So that is very, very good of you. So we're going to spend some time on this question, because this is kind of an important one from our friend Larry. And it's one that kind of, I guess, encompasses some concerns that lots of guitar players have. So Larry's asked the question, hi everyone, I'm a bit overwhelmed by the amount of info that's out there. Nick, how do you narrow in on what to work on? We all know our weaknesses and our strengths. What should take priority? Well, I'm going to draw your attention back to the goal setting streams that we did for this one, Larry, but I'm going to talk you through it as well, because you may have missed that one. It was also about 6 months ago, 7 months ago almost. It was one of our New Year streams when we talked about how to establish goals for the coming year. And I'm going to invite you to take part in some goal setting activities. And you guys who are out there, you can do this too, because it's really, really valuable. So ultimately, if I were to ask you guys honestly, to answer honestly what your guitar playing goals were, your goals would be something like, if I were to answer honestly about my own, It would be something along the lines of be fantastic at the guitar. So, you know, in my mind, that means something like a Guthrie Govan kind of thing, where I'm like, be like Guthrie and not just go gray, which I'm working hard on. So, you know, but we're getting there. That's coming. But, you know, the rest of it, that would be an example of an honest goal. Now, in terms of actually working towards that, that's not something that I can really do anything with. So what you will hear is you'll hear this suggestion that people will give you, meaning very well, and they'll say things like, well, you should set small actionable goals. You know, what does that even mean? Because you end up setting these small little goals of, I will practice my major scale 3 times a week for 15 minutes. How does that work towards becoming a better guitar player? How does that scratch this itch to improve? How does it even stack up compared to doing other things that might help you be a better guitar player? Well, this is where this goal setting thing comes in. And we'll do a bit more concrete stuff as well, but this is something that's worth paying attention to. So I want you to think about your goals in 3 levels. And your top level goal, the ultimate goal, is what we would call your superordinate goal. Superordinate, I'll say that one more time, it's a superordinate goal. Now, these are goals like being able to play fast. I want to be able to play fast. It's the sort of goal that you might think of as a destination. It's where you want to be with your guitar playing. I want to be able to do this. Or it might be, I want to be able to play with feeling, or I want to be able to play songs by ear, etc. But we'll take the example of play fast because it's very easy to quantify. It's one of the reasons why there are so many lessons on how to play fast and so few lessons on how to play with feel. Although we've got a course for that, just throwing that out there. We have 2 courses for that, in fact, by yours truly and several others. But that took some putting together, let me tell you. Not the easiest thing to teach, but that's why it's fun. So anyway, if we take the idea of play fast, that's a superordinate goal. What we might start doing there is we might then take a look at what it means to play fast. And we might start setting some other goals that will form the I want to play fast. So this might be something like, okay, I need to be able to pick at a particular speed. Let's say I need to be able to pick 16th notes at 150 BPM, for argument's sake. That's a specific number that I've chosen for a reason. Anybody who knows that reason, drop it in the comments, because you are a clever person if you know why I've picked that number, or you've certainly been paying attention. So I need to be able to do that. Another thing you might have is I need to have a vocabulary of licks and solos and ideas that I can play fast. Another thing you might have is I need to be able to change strings without making a noise every time I change strings, and to be able to play cleanly. These are all more actionable goals that will feed into play fast. These are what you might call intermediate goals. We're getting somewhere with this. From each of these intermediate goals, let's take the idea of I want to be able to pick at 150 BPM, 16th notes. From here, we spawn several other, what we might call subordinate goals. These are your bottom level goals. And these are more like steps that you might take. So the way to think about it is the ultimate goal, want to play fast, is the destination. These middle goals of pick at this particular speed, be able to change strings fluently, have a vocabulary of licks that I can play at speed, et cetera, et cetera. Those middle goals you might think of as a pathway to the destination. And then these small little goals at the bottom, these subordinate goals rather, are steps that you take on that pathway. And these are the things that you prioritize. So what you would do is you would go, I value this thing up here. This is the path that are gonna take me here. These are the steps I'm gonna take along the path. And if we take our example of playing 16th notes at a particular speed, we might take something like, okay, I am going to practice picking to a metronome, playing a particular exercise. We're going to get as specific as possible with this. It might be, we don't need to go to the close-up cam for this, but it might be something like this exercise. And you're going to work on practicing that exercise. It doesn't actually matter what exercise it is. At a given speed, and you're going to increase that speed week on week. That will service your goal of being able to pick faster. But here's the fun thing. Each one of these little goals that you have down here will have the capacity to service multiple upstream goals. I'll say that one more time. That downstream goal, each one that you have down here, will have the capacity to service multiple upstream goals. So what you can do is, if you sit and one of your goals is to practice that picking thing, another one is to, say, learn some Paul Gilbert licks at a particular speed that you want to play at, that sort of thing, they're both going to feed into those goals, feed into that goal. There is another facet of this, which is quite cool, is that there are multiple ways that you can service in any individual goal. So each goal will service multiple upstream goals, but there are also multiple ways that you can service any upstream goal. I'm going to invite you to go back and watch the goal setting streams that we did around New Year's Eve. That is a very, very, very valuable stream, I think. And I'm going to invite you to take part in some of those goal setting activities, because I think that's really important. But I guess another little flip side of this is, if you were talking about how to practice efficiently, I would suggest probably the best thing to do is to structure your practice in such a way that you can attack multiple objectives at a given time. So what you could do, I'm going to use an analogy that might be kind of gym bro-y here, because I'm a gym bro. But let's say, for example, that you are an individual that wants to gain some muscle mass. I want to grow my body, just all of it. I want to get stronger. If you had all the time in the world and you were into your, you know, bodybuilding type approach of doing things, what I might do is I might divide the body up into individual segments and go, okay, we're going to do an exercise for your quadriceps, we'll do an exercise for your calves, an exercise for your hamstrings, another one for your bum, another one for your abdominals, one for your chest, one for your shoulders, one for the front and the back of your arms, one for this part of your back, one for this part of your back, one for this part of your back, etc. However, that would be a fine way to approach that if you had unlimited time and resources. But if you were very stuck on time, if you could train for 30 minutes, three times a week, let's say, or two times a week, I am going to have you do exercises that train a lot of muscle mass and a lot of other qualities all at once. I'm going to have you do things like a deadlift and an overhead barbell press and a bench press and a squat and a pull-up. Because we can get lots of muscles with a single exercise, and we don't need to attack every single one all at once. Why am I talking about muscle building? Well, the reason is that when it comes to guitar playing, the same thing can be true. If we have multiple goals, like, for example, being able to play more in time, and being able to play over chord changes, and be more expressive, and have a bigger vocabulary, and have a better technique, we can actually attack all of those individually with individual exercises, and we can spend 10 minutes on each one of them. Or if we have an hour to practice, we can spend an hour attacking all of them with a single exercise, which might look something like the structured framework for improvisation. Now, we've talked about this before, but an example of this would be to put a backing track on and to improvise with intent for an hour with some limitations. A good example of limitations would be where you limit the number of strings you're allowed to play on, or you would limit the techniques that you're allowed to use. I'm only allowed to use legato, for example, or I'm only allowed to use strict alternate picking. You would limit the tempo that you're allowed to play at. I must play only quarter notes. You could limit the amount of musical information. It doesn't really matter, but you would find some limitations and you would improvise within these limitations, focusing on the musical outcomes that you want to improve on. So things like, I want to be more expressive and more accurate and have better timing. Well, what's that going to look like? It might look something like this. I'm going to do a structured framework of improvisation very quickly, where I limit myself to the E, D, and B strings. Why not? Pick those at random. In the key of E minor, using just legato technique and playing strictly strictly quarter notes along with this. It might look like this. We'll be right back. so forth. Now, that is an exercise that is going to develop my string skipping, it's going to develop my timing, my finger coordination, my legato technique, my vocabulary, because I'm going to pick up some cool new lines at the time, my timing, I might have already said that, and it's also going to develop my knowledge of the E minor scale up and down the fretboard in ways that I haven't played it yet, or I haven't played it as much. It's a really great way to practice, and I'm tackling all of those things all in a single exercise. I could take them and just break them up and do individual exercises for each, but that would take a very long time. It can get quite wearying. That's a very long answer, but hopefully, Larry, that is of use to you, and it's hopefully of use to some of you guys as well. I really do appreciate your time. Guys, we are pretty much clear out of time on this. We've already run over. I get in trouble for running over on these sort of things, but we are gonna play a little bit more. Once again, I wanna thank you for coming on board. It has been an absolute pleasure having you. We do these every Monday. If you're a new viewer or a returning viewer, we'd love to see you next week. Same place, Guitar Interactive YouTube channel, or wherever it is you happen to be watching. If you wanna help us keep these streams going, a great way to do so is you can go to the URL down below, which is guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-plus, where you will find more lessons like this. There is also a link to that in the description that you can click on, where you can go and get lessons from the likes of myself, Andy Wood, Andy James, Giorgio Cerchi, Michael Caswell, Michelangelo Badio, Lewis Turner, Sam Bell, who else have we missed? Ian Simo, who has this fantastic slide course that I have been learning from, and I've been playing some slide licks for James today, and he's been going, "That's quite nice. Where did he get that from?" I'm like, "Oh, that was Ian Simo. I can't claim any credit for that. That was Ian." Go to that link. That really does help us out. Also, you can give us a thumbs up. You can share this with your guitar playing friends, and you can join us next week. Thanks for having me. My name's Nick Jennison. Let's play a little bit more. Let's get a wall, I think, if I can unstick my cable from it. I think that's more than enough of that nonsense. Thank you so much for having me. My name's Nick Jennison. I will see you guys next week. In the meantime, check this out. This is what you get as part of your GI Plus membership. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters? Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tolson Abasi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.